As part of the public entrance examination coaching scheme, we will be discussing about D block elements and F block elements. This module is divided into two episodes. We will start with episode 1. The position of D block elements is in between S and P block elements in the periodic table. Transition elements generally have an incompletely filled D subshell. This is the most important characteristic of transition elements. D block elements constitute three series of elements in the periodic table. In fact, there is a fourth series also, which contains only artificially synthesized elements. The group 12, that is the zinc group, which contains zinc, cadmium and mercury, have a D10 electronic configuration. Because of the completely filled D subshell, these three elements do not show properties characteristic of transition elements. Now let us see the periodic table. In the periodic table, we can see that the transition elements are placed in between S block and P block elements. The first transition series starts with 21 scandium and ends with 30 zinc. Now let us move on to the general properties of transition elements. Let us start with the electronic configuration. The general outer electronic configuration of transition elements is N minus 1 D 1 to 10 NS 1 to 2. Now let us see a few examples. Let us start with the first transition element, scandium. Scandium has an outer electronic configuration of 3D 1 4S 2. Let us see the electronic configuration of chromium. Chromium has an electronic configuration of 3D 5 4S 1. This electronic configuration, this is due to the extra stability of a half filled D subshell. Now let us see the electronic configuration of copper. The outer electronic configuration of copper is 3D 10 4S 1. This electronic configuration is due to the extra stability of a completely filled D subshell. Now let us see the metallic properties of transition elements. All transition elements are good conductors of electricity and heat. They have metallic luster. All of them are ductile. All transition elements are hard and strong. All transition elements form alloys with one another. Now let us see the ionization energy of transition elements. Ionization energy is the energy required to remove the most loosely bound electron from an isolated gaseous atom. Ionization energies of transition elements are intermediate between those of S and P block elements. Generally, the ionization energy increases from left to right in the periodic table. The minimum ionization energy is shown by lanthanum, which is 541 kilojoule per mole. And the maximum ionization energy is shown by mercury, which is 1007 kilojoule per mole. Now let us see the electrode potentials of transition metals. Electrode potential is the tendency of an electrode to lose or gain electrons when the electrode is in contact with its own ions in solution. Standard electrode potentials of transition elements are generally higher than that of standard hydrogen electrode. Therefore, all first row transition elements except copper are expected to evolve hydrogen on treatment with acids. Even though some of the transition elements like chromium are highly unreactive due to the formation of a protective oxide layer. So, even though we expect that all transition elements except copper can evolve hydrogen from acids, they do not do so because of the presence of protective oxide layer in the case of some of the transition elements. Now let us see the oxidation states of transition elements. One of the important features of transition elements is the variable oxidation state. For example, if we consider manganese, there are several oxidation states possible for manganese: plus 2, plus 3, plus 4, plus 5, plus 6 and plus 7. The maximum oxidation state among transition elements is shown by ruthenium and osmium, which is plus 8. Now let us move on to ionic radii of transition elements. Atomic and ionic radii decrease from left to right in the periodic table. This decrease in ionic radii is due to the poor screening effect of electrons in the subshell. The screening effect of electrons decreases in the order S greater than P greater than D greater than F. The screening effect of D electrons are very less. As a result, the size of atoms and ions of transition elements decreases from left to right in the periodic table. When we consider groups, ionic radii increases from first to second row of transition elements. However, there is not much difference in ionic radii between second and third row. This is due to the presence of lanthanides in between second and third row of transition elements. As a result of lanthanide contraction, transition second and third row transition elements have similar sizes. Let us see the catalytic properties of transition elements. Transition elements and their compounds are excellent catalysts because of two reasons. Because of their ability to show variable valency, they can form unstable intermediate compounds, which makes them good catalyst. Secondly, they can provide surface for the completion of a reaction, or they can provide a surface for a reaction to take place. Because of these two reasons, transition elements are good catalyst. Now, let us see a few examples for the catalytic properties of transition elements. Let us see the compound TiCl3, which is a part of Ziegler-Natta catalyst. Ziegler-Natta catalyst is used for preparing stereoregular polymers. Let us see another example, V2O5, vanadium pentoxide. Vanadium pentoxide is used in the contact process for making sulfuric acid. Spongy iron is used in the Haber process for making ammonia. Palladium chloride, PdCl2, is used in the Wacker process for converting ethylene to acetaldehyde. Palladium is used as a hydrogenation catalyst. Platinum is generally used as a catalyst for reductions. And nickel, Raney nickel, is used as a catalyst for reduction processes. Another important feature of transition elements is the presence of colored ions. Most of the transition elements have colored ions. This is due to the presence of incompletely filled d subshell. There are 5 d orbitals. The 5 d orbitals are degenerate in the neutral atom. But when the metal forms a complex or when it is surrounded by ligands, the degeneracy of the d orbitals is lost, and they get separated into groups of orbitals having different energies. The electrons tend to occupy low-lying or lower energy orbitals, and when they get sufficient energy, they get promoted to higher energy d orbitals. This is known as dd transition. Dd transitions generally takes place by absorbing visible light, and transition metal compounds appear colored. The color of compounds of transition metals is due to dd transitions. The d orbitals in a neutral atom is generally degenerate. That means all d orbitals have the same energy. But when the transition metal form a compound or when they are surrounded by ligands, the degeneracy of the d orbitals is lost. They get separated into groups of d orbitals having different energies. The electrons tend to occupy generally the low energy orbitals. When these electrons accept energy, they get excited to higher energy d orbitals. This excitation generally takes place by absorbing visible light, and the transition metal compounds appear colored. These type of transitions are known as dd transitions. The color of transition metal compounds depends on nature and number of ligands and type of complex formed. There can be tetrahedral, octahedral, and several other type of complexes. Depending on the type of complex formed, the color will be different. Now let us see the color of potassium permanganate. In potassium permanganate, the manganese is in +7 oxidation state. In +7 oxidation state, manganese has no d electrons. Therefore, the color of potassium permanganate is not due to dd transitions. Because of the high oxidation state of manganese, it can accept electrons from the surrounding ligands, that means oxygens. This type of electron transfer from ligand to metal is known as ligand to metal charge transfer, and this charge transfer takes place by absorption of visible light. As a result of this, potassium permanganate appear pink colored. So this charge transfer is the reason for the color of potassium permanganate. Now let us move on to another important property of transition elements, that is complex formation. In order to form complex, we need to have ligands. A ligand is a species which can donate at least a pair of electrons. The complex formation ability of transition metals is due to two important characteristics. The first one is that transition metals have small, highly charged ions. Secondly, they have vacant low energy orbitals to accept electron pairs. The coordination number of a complex is the number of ligands directly attached to the central metal atom. For example, let us consider the case of hexamine cobalt 3 chloride. In this compound, the coordination number of the central metal atom, that is cobalt, is 6. The cobalt metal is surrounded by 6 ammonia groups. As a result, its coordination number is 6. The chloride ions are not part of the coordination sphere. As a result, they are not ligands. Ligands can be classified into unidentate, bidentate, and polydentate ligands depending on the number of electron pairs they donate to the central metal atom. A unidentate ligand donates a pair of electrons to the central metal atom. An example is ammonia. A bidentate ligand can donate 2 pairs of electrons to the central metal atom. An example is ethylene diamine. Polydentate ligands can donate more than 2 electrons to the central metal atom. An important example is EDTA, that is ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid. Now let us see a few questions based on our topic. Let us move on to the first question. The question is, the ground state electronic configuration of chromium is, and our options are A, 3d4 4s2, B, 3d5 4s1, C, 3d4 4s1, D, 3d6 4s0, E, 3d4 4s1 4p1. Let us see the answer. The atomic number of chromium is 24. As a result, there are 6 electrons available for 3d and 4s subshells together. So we expect an electronic configuration of 3d4 4s2, but this is not the case. Because of the extra stability of half-filled d subshell, the actual electronic configuration is 3d5 4s1. So the actual electronic configuration is 3d5 4s1. So our answer is option B, 3d5 4s1. Now let us move on to question 2. The element having the highest first ionization energy among first row transition elements is, our options are A, scandium, B, iron, C, cobalt, D, zinc, and E, titanium. We know that the ionization energy generally increases from left to right in the periodic table. Therefore, the highest ionization energy among first transition series is exhibited by zinc. So our answer is option D, zinc. Let us move on to question number 3. Salts of zinc 2 ions are colorless because, our options are option A, zinc 2 does not possess d electrons so that dd transitions are not possible. Option B, zinc 2 possesses a completely filled d subshell so that dd transitions are not possible. Option C, zinc 2 possesses completely filled S subshell. Option D, zinc 2 possesses completely filled P subshells. Option E, DD transitions are possible with the zinc 2, but these transitions take place in the ultraviolet region. We know that zinc has an electronic configuration of D10S2. So zinc 2 plus ion will have an electronic configuration of d10. So the d subshell of zinc 2 is completely filled. As a result, dd transitions are not possible with the zinc 2 plus ions. Let us move on to question number 4. The question is, the oxidation number of chromium in sodium dichromate Na2Cr2O7 is? Our options are option A plus 5, option B plus 3, option C plus 6, option D plus 2, and option E plus 7. In sodium dichromate, there are two sodium ions. A sodium ion has an oxidation state of plus 1. So 2 into plus 1 plus there are two chromium ions. Let us say the oxidation state of chromium is x. So 2 into plus 1 plus 2x plus, now there are 7 oxygen atoms or oxygen species. Let us say the we know that the oxidation state of oxygen is minus 2. As a result, we can calculate the oxidation state of chromium as 2 into plus 1 plus 2x plus 7 into minus 2 is equal to 0. From this, we can get x, the oxidation state of chromium, as plus 6. So our answer is option C, plus 6. Now let us move on to question number 5. The question is, the coordination number of cobalt in hexamine cobalt 3 chloride is? Our options are option A 6, option B 3, option C 9, option D 5, and option E 4. In hexamine cobalt 3 chloride, the coordination sphere consists of cobalt and 6 ammonia molecules. Therefore, the coordination number of hexamine cobalt 3 chloride is 6. Let us move on to our next question, question number 6. The most stable oxidation state of scandium is? Our options are A plus 1, B plus 2, C plus 3, D plus 4, and E plus 5. We know that scandium is the first transition element and its electronic configuration is d1s2. If scandium loses its 3 electrons, it achieves noble electronic configuration, noble gas electronic configuration. Therefore, the most stable oxidation state of scandium is plus 3. So our answer is option C, plus 3. Let us move on to our next question, question number 7. In which of the following complexes the central metal atom shows an oxidation state of 0? Our options are option A TiCl4, option B FeCn6Cl3, option C NiNH3 6 times Cl2, option D potassium permanganate KMnO4, and option E FeCO5. In almost all carbonyl complexes, the central metal atom is in 0 oxidation state. So our answer is option E, FeCO5. Now let us move on to our next question, question number 8. The question is, which of the following ions is paramagnetic? Option A SC3+, option B Ti4+, option C Cu+, option D Cu2+, and option E Zn2+. For a compound to be paramagnetic, there should be at least one unpaired electron in that complex. If we see our options, SC3+ has no unpaired electron because its electronic configuration is D0S0. Outer electronic configuration is D0S0. Ti4+ also has the same electronic configuration. The electronic configuration of Cu+ is d10. So Cu+ also has no unpaired electrons. The electronic configuration of Cu2+ is d9. Therefore, it contains an unpaired electron. The electronic configuration of Zn2 plus is d10. As a result, Zn2 plus has no unpaired electron. So the only species which contains unpaired electrons in this in these options is Cu2 plus. So our answer is option D, Cu2 plus. Now let us move on to our next question, question number 9. The question is, how many ions will be formed if the complex K3FeCN6 is dissolved in water? Our options are option A, 4, option B, 5, option C, 10, option D, 9, and option E, 3. We know that in a complex, if a ligand, whether it is neutral or charged, is in the coordination sphere, it cannot be ionized. When this particular complex is ionized, we get 4 ions, 3K plus, 3 potassium ions, and an FeCN6, 3 minus ion. Therefore, our answer is option A, 4. Let us move on to our next question, which is question number 10. The question is, zinc, cadmium, and mercury do not show properties characteristic of transition elements because our options are option A, these elements do not possess electrons in d subshell. Option B, these elements are nonmetals. Option C, atoms of these elements and their stable ions have completely filled d subshell. Option D, atoms of these elements and their stable ions are diamagnetic. Option E, atoms of these elements are very small compared to those of other transition elements. We have already seen that zinc, cadmium and mercury and its stable ions have a d10 electronic configuration. Most of the properties of transition elements are due to the presence of an incompletely filled d subshell. Zinc, cadmium and mercury do not have an incompletely filled d subshell. Also, their stable oxidation states do not possess an incompletely filled d subshell. As a result, zinc, cadmium and mercury do not show properties similar to transition elements. So our answer is option C, atoms of these elements and their stable ions have completely filled d subshell. Now let us move on to question number 11. The question is, which of the following ions has a completely filled d subshell? Our options are option A, CO3 plus, option B, CO2 plus, option C, Ti4 plus, option D, CU2 plus, and option E, CU plus. The answer is option E, CU plus. We know that whatever elements we have shown in the options except copper, none of the other elements have a d10 electronic configuration. So none of their ions also cannot have a d10 electronic configuration. So the only ion which has a d10 electronic configuration is Cu plus. Now let us move on to our next question, question number 12. Which first row transition element has the highest covalent radius? Our options are option A, scandium, option B, zinc, option C, copper, option D, titanium, and option E, manganese. We know that covalent radii generally decreases from left to right in the periodic table. This is the case also with transition elements. So among first row transition elements, the highest covalent radius will be shown by scandium. So our answer is option A, scandium. Now let us move on to our next question, question number 13. Which of the following compounds is used in Ziegler-Natta catalyst? The options are option A, manganese dioxide, option B, ferric chloride, option C, Raney nickel, option D, palladium chloride, and option E, TiCl3. We have already seen that in Ziegler-Natta catalyst, we make use of TiCl3. So our answer is option E, TiCl3. Now, let us move on to our next question, question number 14. The question is, which transition element has the lowest melting point? Our options are option A, zinc, option B, mercury, option C, cadmium, option D, silver, and option E, copper. We know that the only transition element which is a liquid is mercury. Therefore, the lowest melting point will be shown by mercury. So, our answer is option B, mercury. Now, let us move on to our next question, question number 15. The question is, the reason for the intense purple color of permanganate ion, MnO4- ion, is due to, our options are option A, DD transitions, option B, FF transitions, option C, polarization, option D, charge transfer, and option E, PP transitions. We have already seen that in permanganate ion, the central metal atom manganese is in +7 oxidation state. In +7 oxidation state, manganese has no d electron. As a result, DD transitions are not possible for manganese, and the reason for the color of permanganate ion is not DD transitions. In potassium permanganate, the manganese is in a very high oxidation state. As a result, it can accept electron density from the surrounding ligands. This type of electron transfer is known as ligand to metal electron transfer, and this takes place by the absorption of visible light, and the color of potassium permanganate is the ligand to metal electron transfer or charge transfer. So, our answer is option D, charge transfer. Now, let us move on to our next question, question number 16. What is the maximum oxidation state observed in transition elements? Our options are option A, +5, option B, +8, option C, +7, option D, +10, and option E, +12. We have already seen that the highest oxidation state among transition metals is shown by ruthenium and osmium, which is +8. So, our answer is option B, +8. Let us move on to our next question, which is question number 17. Why does second and third row transition elements resemble more closely than first and second row transition elements do? Our options are A, first row transition elements are highly electronegative compared to the other two rows. Option B, second and third row transition elements have similar sizes due to lanthanide contraction. Option C, first row transition elements have no electrons in f orbitals. Option D, second and third row transition elements have filled antipenultimate f subshell. Option E, atoms and ions of second and third row transition elements are less intensely colored than those of first row transition elements. We know that a group of elements known as lanthanides exist in between second and third row transition elements. As a result of lanthanide contraction, the sizes of second and third row transition elements are almost identical. Therefore, they have similar properties, and their properties are different from those of first row transition elements. So, our answer is option B, second and third row transition elements have similar sizes due to lanthanide contraction. Now, let us see our next question, which is question number 18. The question is, which is the most abundant transition metal on Earth's surface? Our options are option A, iron, option B, titanium, option C, cobalt, option D, zinc, and option E, copper. This is a straightforward question, and the answer is option A, iron. Let us move on to our next question, which is question number 19. The question is, the maximum oxidation state possible for chromium is? Our options are option A plus 5, option B plus 3, option C plus 6, option D plus 9, and option E plus 7. We know that in chromium there are 6 electrons are available for D and S subshells together. All these electrons can be lost to while forming a compound. Therefore, the maximum oxidation state possible for chromium is plus 6. So, our answer is option C, plus 6. Now, let us see our last question, question number 20. The question is, molybdenum and tungsten have almost identical sizes. Identify the reason for this phenomenon. Our options are, option A, molybdenum and tungsten belong to the same group. Option B, both are transition elements. Option C, atoms of both elements have incomplete D subshell. Option D, both molybdenum and tungsten are metals. Option E, lanthanide contraction. We have already seen that as a result of lanthanide contraction, second row and the third row transition elements have identical sizes. Molybdenum belong to the second row transition elements and tungsten belong to the third row transition elements. Because of lanthanide contraction, molybdenum and tungsten have similar sizes. So, our answer is option E, lanthanide contraction. Let us summarize what we have discussed in our class today. We have seen that the transition elements are placed in between S block and P block elements in the periodic table. They are called transition elements because they show the transition in properties from S block to P block elements. We have seen that the transition series, the first transition series starts with the scandium and ends with the zinc. The properties of the first transition series is different from those of second and third transition series. This is due to the similarity in sizes of second and third transition row elements. This similarity in size is due to lanthanide contraction. There are a group of elements called lanthanides are placed in between the second and third transition series. As a result, they have similar sizes. Because of their similarity in sizes, they have similar properties also. So, we have seen the important properties of transition elements. We have seen that the ionization energy generally increases from left to right in the periodic table. So, among the first transition series, the minimum ionization energy is shown by scandium and the highest ionization energy is shown by zinc. Another characteristic which distinguishes transition elements from S block and P block elements is their ability to possess variable valency or variable oxidation states. For example, we know that iron can exist in two important oxidation states, Fe2 plus the ferrous state and Fe3 plus the ferric state. Almost all transition elements can exist in different oxidation states. That is another important property of transition elements. Another important property is their ability to form complexes. A complex is formed when a ligand is connected to a transition metal. Ligands are species which can donate at least a pair of electrons to the central metal ion. There are different types of complexes based on the number of ligands. There are tetrahedral complexes in which the number of ligands is 4. There are octahedral complexes in which the number of ligands is 6. The color of the compound depends on the type of the complex. For example, the color of a tetrahedral complex will be different from the color of an octahedral complex, even though the type of ligands and central metal atom is the same. Another important feature of transition elements is their ability to show color in their compounds. Transition, the compounds of transition elements are generally colored. The color of transition element compounds is due to DD transitions. The D orbitals in a neutral transition element atom is degenerate. Degenerate means all D orbitals have the same energy. But when ligands approach the transition metal, the degeneracy of the D orbitals is lost. That means they get separated into groups of D orbitals having different energies. The electrons in the transition metal tend to occupy low energy D orbitals, and as a result we have a set of D orbitals having low energy which is filled with electrons, and a set of higher energy D orbitals which is filled with which is not filled with electrons. So when the compound absorb energy, the electrons present in the low energy orbital get excited to the higher energy orbital, and this transition is known as DD transition. These DD transitions generally takes place by absorption of visible light, and the compounds appear colored. DD transitions is not the only reason for the color of transition metal complexes. For example, let us take the case of potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate. In both potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate, the central metal atom is in a very high oxidation state, and there are no d electrons present in the central metal atom. Because of the high oxidation state, these species can accept electron density from the surrounding ligands. This is known as charge transfer or ligand to metal charge transfer. The color of potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate is due to ligand to metal charge transfer transitions. Transition elements and their compounds find applications in catalysis also. I am concluding the first episode. Thank you.